afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another exciting Propaganda Cast with me, your host, Imperial Dane. We're off here to a splendid 2-2 here on the road to Kharkov. Yes, indeed, a 2-2. I know there's not a lot of them, but I mean, a lot of them lately do tend to sort of get a bit, you know, much the same, in particular in terms of there's very little maneuver, anything sort of interesting, sort of otherwise make up for it. We're going to a 2-2 here with Strammingbird and Sarak here fighting for Deutschland, for the Reich. Fighting here for the 3rd SS Panzer Division, Tonkopf charging ahead versus the Russians under command here of Flaming Hammer and Kabel. Fighting here for the 85th Rifle Corps, tasked with holding this part of ground and hold the line no matter what. Well, Comrade Stalin will have your heads. Well, that got Flaming Hammer, I suppose, fits in nicely. We've got an immediate charge here, by the way, of defensive tactics. Pretty random, in particular 2-2. We got here armored assault, shock motor, shock army. We got Jägerrammer, lightning wall, close air support here for Strongbird and for Sadok. Got fortifications, special operations, and scavenge. Quick bit of spot wire here of the reinforced steel barricade kind. Ready for action. Enough, no rush with a few. We got a cool banner following up. We got the infantry coming up. We got grenadiers here running for Strammingbird. Shots here, we got pioneers rushing forwards here. Wire here, not quite finished. Points here being secured, and we've got an early support company about here from Kabel, who's by the way got full mine bulletins, whereas he's got actually a Dushka bulletin and some infantry there. Tiger infantry machine gun, and a bit the same there, otherwise. But maximum up here for Flaming Hammer. Comes here, force back with a Sturm Pioneer. Cooldown rates up, got bat wire going up, and there's a lot of sort of bat wiring going on from most players in this engagement. Very interesting, some early fortifications work there. Pioneers here coming in for the contract moving hit, already here a bit of danger. MG42 is on the way though for Strong, but until then he's going to be in a perilous situation. Truck there not doing much. Kubank's jumping in the much right hand side. Cubs there taking Mount Lost, he's finally got Cubs there firing in as well. Achtung. But why not quite finished? We've got the truck moving down. Moving up here. So so far most of the fight going down here. Grenadiers there, pioneers, more grenadiers, likely the MG42 will arrive soon enough to assist here. Not looking too good positions here for Strongbird, by the way, his guns here already in a pretty perilous position. He'll have to pull back, and these guns, well, we need to get into a better position. They're quickly getting flanked out here. Maxim joining in here, which looks like Kabel supporting Flaming Hammer. Need a bit of lighter here, but nothing really sort of moving forward into the German position. Kubai Murat to support here. So all of a sudden, we're seeing a bit of focus on the left hand side from, well, all four players to varying degrees, where Sarek, though, still maintaining most of the focus on the right hand side, trying to regain territory there, which is good to see. Molotov there straight through the windows, lighting that side of the building on fire. Contra engineers here getting suppressed by an MG42. Loads of machine gun fire going down. There we go. We got a mort up here from Strammingbird. Moving up swiftly. Contra moving ahead there. Kuppelwagen there. Sturmpionier. And the MG here flying. Well. At the cool bag, but already getting suppressed here. We've got Steel Pilot joining in. This piece of the advantage there for Kabel, and there we go, he is forced away. Three countries there for him, and meanwhile, Flaming Hammer continues his flaming advance or something, I don't know. No flame throws for him. As of yet, anyways. Fox is here. Rather quickly, I'm here, but then outnumbered more. Specifically altered by the country and comedy. Kuban quite a lot of support. There's only one country support. The advance comes up here. There's not really much here from Sarek to stop him right there. Choosing about here, getting flanked on several positions. The Russians keeping up our pressure, though we are now seeing a bit more counter pressure here from Strammingbird. Now laying down mortar. We got minesweepers up. Clearly all here worried about the fact that, or the potential here, that Flaming Hammer's already mined up a lot of the territory. And that is certainly always something you have to worry about, or a demo charge for that matter. World place demo charge early on could easily throw things off here for Strammingbird. Points are being scored, troops against the press. The Kuban's trying to do what they can there, but the Germans are very much under pressure now. Strammingbird is striking back here for the Reich, where Sarek is sort of, you know, just trying to hold on, it seems here. Sturm Pioneer are close to getting wiped out. Nicht gut. Guns are there under heavy fire. There might be a mort. Looks like, oh, there we go, one mort left, but not really expensive towards the one that sort of could have been mostly forced out of building. That's denying some good cover there for Strammingbird. MG42 joining in. There you go, the follow-up Molotov here, another grenade squad there on the way for Strammingbird. And there you go, Flaming Hammer's been pushed up, and meanwhile he's managed to wire off this spot here. Basically funneling in Strammingbird, or any German plane to this area, more specifically, which will towards make more defense. We got a minesweep push in here, clearing up with this Martin on the retreat path. It probably would have benefited more had he actually set it up right here, because, again, it's a funnel. Challenge them in that case, an S-Mart field, they would have much better catching on retreat. Though, of course, if that wasn't his intention, of course, fair enough. But, you know, just a heads up there. Either way, though, he's managed now a really good push against here. Flaming Hammer clearly wasn't expecting this kind of action from Strumming Bird. Reasonably nicely executed there, but needs to quickly get some territory, maybe set up something to sort of slow down any further counterattacks. Now we've got Sargos pushing back here. The Germans are all thrown a bit back here. We've got a bad group headquarters up for Sardic. Take up here for Strumming Bird.
We have liberated this sector.
Bunker right around here could work. Got a field gun now arriving for Kabel, for Flaming Hammer. We've got a Dushka out. You got engineers further around there, so further engineers. Alternating numerous mine bulletins there for Kabel. Numerous. But so far, he's actually laying on a single one, and like ultimately why something but went so easily for mines people. Bunker going up here, but already heavily damaged. Interesting position. He's going to basically try and sort of deny the cut-off point for as long as possible. At the same time, now he's sort of basically not quite there, and I don't think he actually upgraded due to the fact it's right on the this part of the territory, so basically if he gets neutralized, otherwise he can't upgrade it. So now it's basically 150 minutes he can't, or manpower, out the window. But there you go, nice length from the Grenadiers here, catching the Dushka. Could he get it? Could he get it? Oh dear, there we go. He might get it. It's a bit clumped up, and there's too many Grenadiers, of course, arriving it. And there we go, just wiped. But at the same time, we've got Engineer Country Control going in from the south here.
We have lost the machine gun.
Bunker being repaired. More to nowhere to be seen. Might want to get up something further here. No Doctrine power here from the Germans or from Kabel. Engineers a bit of trouble. Grenadiers need to go away as well. They're in a pretty bad position. He actually managed to get away with the Dushka. The cheeky bastard there managed to make off with the Dushka heavy machine gun. More troops rushing in here from Kabel to assist. It looks like they're giving up here on Sarek's half of the map. Sarek, by the way, he's not actually doing a lot, so really assist. He seems to be sort of getting more Stuum Pionera, but not really sort of building up defense or preparing anything over here in the meanwhile, you know, while Stumming Bird is now keeping both Serp players occupied. In fact, being pushed back forward, so there seems a bit of sort of slight dysfunction there. Maybe this part of our overall plan, who knows? But it certainly does bear pointing out. Strong Butcher probably can either consider taking up further and rush for some Panzers, or need to get up the light to make a nice company. Otherwise, something needs to happen. Stuum Pionera here, and they're going to give support catching the conscripts. Quick rush over there. But now, Strongbot does have several machine guns now, although of slightly varying caliber and potency. Stuum Pionera here, quickly force out the building, and it is lit on fire like a hazardous Chinese toy. Troops are advancing, Fulton's coming up with Pantrix here, so already Sergius preparing for that. He's gone fortification. Fortification, MG-34's out. MG-34's out. Fuel catch up by the here on the cut-off point, good position there, so it also helps both sort of players. They're getting further fuel for further adventures. And we've got a tank for 10 come out there, so it'll be a Rama rush there from Carbon most likely. Dushka and MG-40 ready to stop the sort of advances there. Meanwhile, Sarek is not really doing much. He's not, for example, applying pressure over here. Sort of trying to flank the Sword forces, moves up here into Strumming Bird's territory. I mean, that could always be a good move. I mean, that's always something to consider. And if, you know, your teammate's being attacked, you know, you can have him either going to attack the defender or not. But basically, you can try and flank the attackers and catch them off guard that way. Though it tends to be the option a lot of players feel neglect, which is a bit weird. But there you go. Engine Fed 4 here, though. Bit of ladder action here. Still overall, Sarek. Looks like he's fun. Sort of going to sort of try and counterattack from the other side. Trying sort of get them there in the flank. And my god, what is this? A Soviet player's using tank traps. I haven't seen that in ever, I think. By the gods. Now just here getting absolutely pelted with Molotovs, as if though it was going out of style. But basically, he's really intent, it seems, on basically creating a funnel towards here, which also, of course, allows it to make it much easier for him to defend this area. I mean, that, of course, is one way to use barbed wire, but also tank traps. I mean, it does require more time. Of course, that guy, you know, the troops fighting here will certainly do the work quite nicely. But basically, by funneling in, he can defend much easier, because, again, there's less room for the opponent to maneuver on. And that's really important, for example, in fighting tank field and the opponent, of course, the Germans in particular, as well. So, overall, nicely done here by Flaming Hammer. You're going to make it much harder for any German arm sort of maneuver about here. They're going to then have to either spend time wrecking this or sort of drive through here. And it also allows it to sort of make it more easy to sort of focus mines. You got mines, we've got MG42 in Grenadiers. Overall, the Soviets are still on the back foot. We got another fuel catch up, but certainly it's not all bad. And there you go, Engineers getting suppressed here. And there we go, forced away. Doom Puny are moving out. And they're going about, and the SMG-4 2 more supporting. Dushka moving out as well. He's got a pack 40 out. He could consider half taking it, so he doesn't have to always retreat. That's always a good thing. Command Bank Ultra and send out his man to clear out the fuel cache. Otherwise, Storming Bark could consider taking up. Fuel cache is, by the way, would also be a good thing. That would also help Sarak get more fuel. Share punch at quarters up. Comes to the end of fire. And we got a mechanized armor company up here for flaming hammers. Bloody splendorific. There's end of fire. We got Rearsmith. Aggressive attacking, they're going to bring up the field gun, bombarding cable is, or Kabul is not late to the support. McKen Mev's on the way here for Sarek, not spending all his munitions on punches, makes it seems. Nice to see. Grenadiers here, lots of. Oh! Might see a unit wipe there, might see a unit wipe. More time going in the conscripts as they push forward here. In this case, of course, the tank tanks also serve as an obstacle to them a bit. In this case, you already need three bodies for Zeal and all that. Basically, catch on fire and die horribly. So it doesn't always work out. Comes then moving in, flanking in the front, gonna deal it. Could move up here and harass a bit though from Kabul. And we got the Tiger Battalion Command. He's not getting a T-70, which would always be a quick sort of thing to get. T-34, of course, is another option. In fact, he's got a bit of manpower there. Flooding out a fuel cache here would also be a good move. I mean, the more fuel caches, the better. Dushka here holding up nicely. Further troops marching onwards. Pushing up here as Sarek is pushing down, but overall he's not really doing a lot, and it's overall at the moment strumming, but doing most of the fighting in the sense that we've got some overslide now on the way here for Sarek, which might cause a plan with a bit more punching power. Sarek, by the way, getting closer to reasonably close in a few moments, I suppose, particularly if Strongberg gets up some fuel cash to get a Panther up, which would probably have helped. T-70 then the way, then for Kabul, so in the end he did go for the T-70 light tank. Feel good about to be lost. Territory being traded back and forth here between the two sides. Certainly large amounts of infantry. And we got a Katusha up here for Flamingham. A Katusha. We got more tank types. We got mines here. I mean, by the looks of it, he's basically sort of trying to make it difficult for him to sort of rush through. He's basically trying to, again, limit the maneuvering ability of any flankers and harassers. Basically, if he sort of gets to try to sort of flank in from here, for example, the tank traps are basically there to sort of funnel him into the mines and such. Interesting, interesting. Some really advanced defense theory there we've seen from Flaming Hammer, which is overall pretty impressive to see. Katusha firing here. Straight by the looks of it into the German lines and mine! God! Pioneers wiped out! MG wiped out! Mortar wiped out! Grenadiers wiped out! That is the most devastating Katusha balance I have seen in ages and at that range! He just slaughtered Strumming Bird. Strumming Bird's got barely anything left. That just tore out his artery. Fosca's here doing damage, knocking out T-70. So it's not all, you know, beer and skills here for the Soviet Union. But certainly they have managed to cripple Strumming Bird pretty severely. I mean, he's heavily lacking on everything. Plus, he's actually wrecking his own equipment to deny it to the Russians. Right now, of course, the choice of Doctor would probably be actually to go for Lightning Wall, get relief infantry up that way, try and replace all the losses he's suffered, you know. Try to use some sort of flesh out things. At the same time, though, I fear he might be going, but only just to play for Tiger Tanks, which are all not really strong, in particular not his concentration. But that Katusha, absolute fiendish magic. Not magic, but you know. Point there being secured. That's definitely going to leave a lot of the burden now on Sarek's shoulders. No rule, Sarek. I mean, he's very much sort of holding back. I mean, he's just sort of signing in. And he's something I see in a lot of team game players. I mean, good and bad, you know. In terms of rank, there is. Anyways, they just sort of decide, you know, okay, I've gotten to this point. I'm not going to do anymore. This is my part of the map. And it can be a bit of a slightly, you know, wrong thought. You know, you tend to sort of ignore and try to ignore opportunities for example, to catch your opponent off guard and sort of do a lot of damage because even if they focus on them, of course, that means they're going to gaps elsewhere you can take advantage of. And that guy, you know, again, and that's also why, for example, I do find a lot of team games boring because ultimately team games for a lot of people just means, you know, bunching up, hammering away, not really, you know, any greater intelligent maneuvering, which is, you know, really what should be happening. Anyway, it's got the Kuban, the moving head there with the protection mode on, jumping in. We've got T-70 number 2 rushing in. Coming here from Panchlex again. Need to be careful there, Kabul. Petrucci moving up again, could be firing off another devastating badass beyond all compare at the same time here. Another deuce cut for Flaming Hammer, stopping Gunnadius from advancing any further. Got a field gun here coming as well. Interesting enough, he's not finished this, by the way. He's not finished this. Conscience here, by the way, with a pilfered light machine gun. Please, anything repaired. Getting pushed back here, we got Gunnadius. Deuce cut pushing forward. Mortimering up support as well. Strongbird has yet to tag up, so it's clear at this point he's aiming for the Tiger. And I feel in that regard, he's missing out on opportunities to further allowing the Surge, for example, to dig in and prepare, but also do damage. And for example, heading, for example, going for armor much faster. He could probably sort of punish all this, maybe even caught the Katusha, knocked it out. And maybe even, you know, prevent some of those catastrophic damage. And almost lost the Gunnadius squad there as well. That Katusha is just tearing apart things there. And even the cart gets wrecked by this murderous vehicle's barrage. An innocent wooden cart. Panther in the race on the way here for Sarak. Maybe the Panzer Kampfwagen can turn the tide. But there's also another sort of clearance sign here that Sarak maybe is just playing a bit too defensive. I mean, he's several points behind his teammate and the enemy. I mean, that's usually again the sign that someone's playing perhaps a bit too defensively. And of course, I mean, he's fortifications, but even then, I'd rather feel like he's taking it a bit too literal. And in that regard, again, he's leaving Strong Virtual to take it. Now we're seeing sort of the ultimate consequence. There's a huge gap there in force size now between the two. And of course, the funny thing is, despite being fortification, he's not really done a lot to fortify. Not a lot about why. No tank traps for him, by the way. No emplacements, no bunkers, no nothing. And I gotta feel like Sarak might have been taking things a bit here too lightly. Anyways, Panther here's a pouring in. He pushed, Fulton is leading the way. I might want to use cover a bit more and spread out a bit. We've got a barrage going down there. Nicely done there by Kabul. Student Puno flanking, but there you go. T70 ready to deal with that flank. Go roll. Nicely done there. He's showing the field guns aren't easily cleared out. And the field guns toward the T70 itself is easily knocked out, for example, by a Panther. Overall digging here. We've got mines going down. So basically, he's really preparing sort of an in-depth defense. So there you go. He finished the tank traps. Certainly. I mean, the Soviets were generally sort of good, you know, building up sort of some decent defense out of nowhere just to basically slow down any German advance. And usually they did to sort of extend like barbed wire mines and sort of other obstacles. I mean, overall, I mean, if you can rob a German attack, well, any kind of attack with speed overall, I mean, you could sort of, well, overall, also rob it a lot of its power. Since, of course, a non-moving force is a lot easier to hit. But comes there close, getting wiped out. Not looking good there. And there we go, Tort. He has gone for Lightning War, and we're not seeing anything else. He's clearly aiming for the Tiger, not only to see a relief infantry there in use. Most sad. We got Panzer Gunner now here running for Strumming Bird. And H-35 up now as well here for Flaming Hammer, clearly not taking any chances. Well done, well done. Petrucci all the way over here. As Kabul here sort of creeps forwards against Sarak, who's now himself seemingly taking some nasty losses as well. Duska sorted out. So pressure keeps up. And another Katusha barrage here. Veterans E1, Veterans E1 might even get the enemy. Oh, there we go. Machine gun absolutely annihilated. Annihilated. Also got an MU-34 that covering things. And there's a huge gap here between the two forces. Now, this is actually also a bit accurate. There's not actually a tendency for some commanders trying to sort of flank you up with two divisions, for example, we're sort of close to each other and sort of attacking there, since usually either side will not be keeping an eye. And there we go. And that is what happened here. Neither player was actually keeping an eye on the center. Sag rush in, quickly got the Katusha there. Nicely executed there. Nice attack of opportunity. Nice attack of opportunity there. And there we go. We got a Tiger out here now for Strongbird. I'd rather again, I'm a bit disappointed in that. And of course, have to see how it works out. Still maintaining defense. We got the German mortar in trouble. Strongbird's forces are in trouble at the moment. So the situation is not good. Mine here. And there you go. Tiger with pack support moving forward. Take concepts in rather deep trouble. We got Pioneers here going for the cut point. Strongbird doing his best to somehow do some damage, even if things are not good. Panther joining up with the Tiger could be there going to try and make a push, but again, basically the way that Flaming Hammer has fortified this area, any sort of push is going to be dangerous. In particular, there's going to be no chance here, for example, for the Panther to utilize his speed to sort of flank about. And of course, that's only going to also throw him into the mines. Folks was in a bit of trouble. Maxim stopping things there. Cabo, though, is floating way too much resources, my liking. Again, fuel caches would be good. I mean, you've got nothing to spend on it. Get cash. He's also the last player not to have chosen a doctrine yet. And we're in 20 minutes. I mean, armored assault, a shock roach, either could work right now and get some armor out. Stop floating.
Engineer standing by. HMG crew is ready. Standing by. Da-da.
You're not here to float like a butterfly. Anyways, Tiger there with Panther.
You have orders?
The point is ours.
There you go, victory point secured. Looks like both German players are getting a bit more passive here. Well, sagging further. Strong but a bit more grudgingly. Pairing here, sensing a pairing that's going to assault here. Field gun pulling back. Can't as well. Overall, good reaction there from Kabul. So time to build more distance there just in case. Ultimately, he's using his T-70 to actually spot for the field gun as well. Clever, clever. Not something a lot of players actually do. Now it's actually Flaming Hammer's chance, seems a bit passive, but at the same time, even then, he's using part of his force of attack elsewhere. And there you go, Katusha joining in, firing away here. In this case, not really hitting much, and oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. Katusha there. Ah, needs to get away. There we go, Katusha knocked out, but there you go, anti-tank grenades landing on the rear of the Tiger. Field guns opening up, there's one fact, the Tiger here. In this case, Strong Bird apparently thought his Tiger was a Panther. It's not. Not very fast enough. And there you go, easily knocked out. That was a senseless rush right there by Strongbird. I mean, he got a tight Katusha, but I wouldn't say a tiger was worth it. That was just a waste of valuable Wehrmacht materials. And now Strongbird is back there to square. Not very good. As you find the reports here. And now here, Flaming Hammer's taking the offensive after the Tiger's gone. That means only a Panther. And certainly, again, mostly Sarek to hold the terrain. And again, Sarek, unlike Flaming Hammer, has not prepared. All right, Tovarish, shoot that tree! Don't you mean that German thing behind it? Yes, yes. And there's Panther moving in there. And the H-5, the tends to be pretty bad, pushing the vision focus sight. Which does give a chance here. Panther does not pursue, though. Panther does not pursue, apparently worried here about Kranzkopf, obviously. And there going to tank. Grenade went through there, damaging the engine. Badger chasing there for him. And checked time here for the mid-game analysis. Country chasing. Oh, dear, called in another Tiger, didn't he? But country chasing for the Germans is they're losing terrain. Steinberg is constantly in a state of not very good. He's taking massive casualties. Barely got any infantry. Barely any support weapons. He keeps pouring resources into the Tiger. He's not doing anything to leave it. Even say, you know, relief infantry to somehow that way get some numbers back. I mean, overall, Strongback at this point has been relegated to a support role for Sarek. And the problem with Sarek is he's himself way too passive. So at the moment, he's sort of, you know, again, landing in a bit of a corner here. He can't really do much. And overall, the Soviets sort of moving forwards and dominating the map, even despite, you know, perhaps not quite much themselves either. They do enjoy a bit more initiative compared to their opponents. The victory point was, they're actually quite behind. And of course, again, the thing is with Sarek, I mean, despite him going for fortification, he's not fortified nearly anywhere as much as the guy who just went for defensive has. Which again, you know, does indicate a bit of a problem there for Sarek. Overall, what can the Germans do? I mean, really, apart from saying, you know, Strangbert trying to get some relief infantry up, get some fuel caches up as well to support both him and his teammate. And I want you to get some more infantry out otherwise of the regular kind, and considering I'm going for some regular armor, not just Tigers all the bloody time. For Sarek, I mean, get that Panther repaired. That's obviously a main priority. Pack 43 is also going to do well, though a part of me does feel it might be a bit too far back. And even then, with a Katusha out, and a, well, Katusha's out on the field, of course, I mean, it's going to see some limited use. It could easily be knocked out. So in that regard, things are not quite that straightforward there for Sarek. And of course, the question is, if maybe not aiming for another Panther might not have been wise, and then sort of going for an armored assault somewhere. Or maybe even a Sturm Tiger to support, you know, clear out some of those fuel guns and whatnot. I mean, overall, a few options there for Sarek. For the Soviets, I mean, they need to sort of partly fill out some of the infantry losses, get a bit more armor. I mean, they are losing a lot of vehicles in particular, and Kabul. Choose your doctrine, get some caches up. I mean, stop floating so much. It's embarrassing at this point, you know. Just make up your mind. and go on the offensive. At this point, he could easily go for an IZU-152 if he wanted. I mean, there's no reason to float that much manpower. Again, he could have gone for it sooner had he gotten fuel caches up sooner. Well, more than that one, that is. So, you know, a few issues there. With Flaming Hammer, more Katusas are good. Maybe another HD5, and I'll try to keep up the pressure and try to flank the Germans as well. But let's hear a return to the fighting as the second Tiger arrives. Artillery, mortar fire, T-70 fire, and MG-34 there on the run.
Gänsemarsch! Protect the flank!
Volksgrenadiers back to full strength.
Structure is up!
More mines. I mean, now actually, Flaming Hammer needs to be careful. I mean, he's placing way too mines into his own territory, and specifically around his own vehicle. I mean, he could easily end up backfiring on him and resulting in some heavy damage to his own equipment and men. So be careful about your mines as well. I mean, good with mining, but, you know, be considerate about where your own men are going to be around those mines. Otherwise, I mean, you're making the job easier for your opponent, not harder, which is rather what you should always be aiming for. Stump Pioneer there charging forward. Nice hit down the HD5. The Pac-43 ops up there with the high velocity 80mm gun. HD5 may manage to escape engineers, being easily cleared by Stump Pioneer. Mortified joining in there from Strammingbird, veteran von Rommel 32. And the orbital on the top getting bombarded by the field gun. And Tiger moves ahead, coming under fire here from something. Oh, the field gun there. Nicely done, nicely done. Panther not being repaired.
Let's go!
Civilian power near nowhere in sight, and there's no mechanized regiment either. Oh, looks like the T-70 finally bit the dust here. At the same time, Katusha Barrow's going down here on the Pac-43. Pac-40 cleared out. And the Pac-40 as well there. And finally, Cabal chooses shock motor, shockingly, and goes for an ice. I mean, he's turning up over often, you see, but even then, you know, I would have liked to see him a bit more cleanly executed there with less manpower float. But there you go. Heavy assault gun out, Sphero Boy or Beast Killer. Talkstring Henry, we got the Tiger hang button in repairs. Interesting enough, he's not fixing his own Panther first, the one, you know, which could also be of quite a bit of help. Then he goes for the Tiger. Same time, Panther is moving forward here, with the Panther getting the HD5 hit at the same time, getting suppressed. Assault up here fails tragically as it runs straight into the field gun. Now, of course, the conscripts. A lack of support was there from either German player, really not helping things out. There you go, Panzer Grenadier run off the field. There we go, ISU moves ahead with its 152mm gun. Mortar on the way there for Strammingbird, a second one. And in mortality, they're still going to have a bit of a hard time there competing with Flaming Hammer's rocket hammer, if you will. Ashby took it from the pack, 43, but then just pulls a bit back and then begins blasting the life out of the Germans. Tiger flanks in. Hits a mine. Not good there, not good. Strammingbird needs to support his Tiger tank, but he's not doing it in part because he doesn't have a lot of infantry tanks to support with. And also got a cache here. Probably meant to heal, but yeah, there's a battle group headquarters right next to it. Smoke being laid down here. Good job there, good job there. Too bad, and there's field guns and eyes you hear blasting away, but managed to get behind the wreckage of the shed, saving the day for the Tiger crew, at least for now. We got more tank traps again. Note the way he's setting up here in this cross is to sort of prevent the path, but also it's to sort of again funnel in, but also more specifically, deny a straight path. I mean, again, you know, also being able to deny a straight path to your opponent can also do a lot to sort of, you know, slow down an assault. It could also, for example, mean, you know, oh dear, I have to turn a bit. It could, you know, in theory, actually risk exposing the rear a bit more to the enemy as it turns. So, a lot of interesting thought here from Flaming Hammer. It's overall very interesting to watch. Cavil again, though. Start floating manpower. Portugal saying out north there. ISU continues on button. There you go. Building collapsed. Wiping out the Kenner from the inside. There you go. Another Katusha Bash around here. Mortar's close to getting knocked out there. ISU continues to get attacked. And finally, the Panda, by the way, is ready. Finally! Got a second Katusha out here, by the way, now for Flaming Hammer. More tank traps here. We're again trying to sort of funnel and, well, entrap enemy armor. Splendid work there by Fleming Hammer. Punch gonna be in a bit of trouble. And he's going for a mechanized regiment. He's called up a Stuka Sufus. And. Yep, fired away. Gotta try and knock out some of the support in the ISU. Maybe even the ISU, which is actually still quite damaged, but there you go. Doesn't really kill a lot, certainly not compared to the Katrusas, which have so far been rather on fire this match. In some cases, literally been on fire as he got under enemy fire, knocked out. Got another badge round here. Panther takes it. Looks like he's going after the ISU, in which case he'll probably wait. There we go, move in. Blitz! Blitz! Vorwärts! Schnell! Instead, he stops moving through there. In fact, pulls back and remains in line of fire. In fact, takes a needless hit. Also misses out an opportunity to actually flank the ISU and knock it out. Instead, we've got the Tiger moving in here, flanking in. Very slowly. And again, you know, there's a missed opportunity here from Sag and Strongbucks, and then actually pull off a pinch result on the ISU in the field gun position, knocking it out instead. The Tiger sort of gives it away already and misses a golden opportunity there. Plus, ball sets up the field gun ready to sort of break it apart. Overall, the Germans are nicely contained in there. Half the map here by the Soviets. Have they trapped themselves? Dimitri, how are we trapped?
Mystics. What? There's a witch about. Stop being an idiot.
Maxim there cleared out, shooting up here for the center. Careful with the Tiger, Swarming Bird, 4-6. Still no sign of relief infantry, though he's sort of building up his infantry forces again, flirting them out a bit. Fleming Hammer at full pop cap. He's got three Katyushas now. Three Katyushas. Now that's it. And there we go. We're just seeing a massive rocket barrage. They're doomed. Just striking down here around the center of Saxon Sunkbat position. Hammering away at the Swear Punch headquarters. Absolutely amazing stuff they've rarely seen. Almost knocking out the Swear Punch headquarters, in fact. Crazy fight here, ISU slowly moving ahead. Pack for the fleet being repaired, not the crew though. Stuka's Roos not doing much to fight again. The Panther not reaching much again. You know, Tarago rule feels much too passionate in this battle. Unit wiped down, in fact, that was the Obersoldaten. Those were the Obersoldaten. And Maxim cleared out again here by the heroic deeds of the Grenadier. And another massive barrage here, catching the Tiger's repair crew. And of course, spare punch, of course, we imagine is the target here of this ceaseless barraging from Flaming Hammer. Units there hanging about. Panther getting ready. Finally. Should use Blitzkrieg though. Blitzkrieg, Vorwärts, Vorwärts. Achtung! Instead, what he does is basically stop up. Instead of Blitzkrieg, just moving forward as fast as he can. Remember, in some cases, speed is key. Now he uses Blitzkrieg. Now he uses. And then still stops up while using it. Still stops up while using it. He doesn't try to get behind all the field guns in the ISU. That was just terribly handed there by Sarok with that Panther. I have no idea what he's thinking. Maybe a misclick or something, I don't know. But Tiger moves in there for the final kill. There we go, knocking out the ISU. Fugan firing away. Katyusha bombarding. So many Katyushas in a 2 versus 2. And there you go, Spare Panther quarters finally, but a dream. And he's called in another ISU. That's two ISUs there. Well, the first one, of course, is blown up. Silly me.
We are bleeding, comrade! Okay, that's the last one.
But three Katyushas, pretty rare, pretty rare.
Enemy forces are securing our
Germans
territory.
Continue to lose ground here, they're losing victory points. And they are losing. Maybe. Conscious there, leading the advance, getting that victory point, coming out of fire, Tiger fires away, we've got full smithies, we've got the pack 40. Kubang somehow still alive, but so far seems like Sarak has just pulled away and forgotten all about it. Tiger almost down, taking several hits, there we go, field guns joining in. Pack 43 almost knocked out, ISU firing away there. And Pack 43 gets hit back, but they're not before the crew then proceeds to die horribly.
We now have access to ISU.
And what is this? We've got searing artillery. Around here, it seems. Pack 43 recruit. Actually gaining some kills there. Field gun bombarding him up. Get knocked out by the searing artillery. Pack 43 taking hits there. And there, guys, you almost knocked out. There go, field gun down. Pack 43 almost got knocked out by the Pack 43, but he does escape here. The Wrath of the Schwerer pans up. There can only a small series of blows are delivered. Carbon floating less resource, but still needs to do less. Petrusius bombarding away. Stream of rockets flying through the air. There we go, Pack 43 down. Might even see the Fosco's retreating right past it like that as well. Tiger effects were up, but there's not much really here left for Sarlacc. He could probably try and aim for another Panther. So he might want to trade for fuel then, or he could go for King Tiger. Either way, no decision needs to be made, and fuel needs to be gained. Strong bets, Carbolic, a tons of manpower. Fuel caster still would be good. Going for another Tiger, another Tiger. Field gun barrage in. Oh, Stuka's Fuss barrage is unleashed. Not doing too much, even as losses are inflicted there. Barely any use left now for Sarlacc. On the other hand, now it's Strongberg who's ascendant. You can hear Stuka close air support barrage here for the. Right. Crazy finding here. Left side barely seeing any action. Basically, they've given up. They're just trying to hold this area to take it back. So basically, as the Germans are getting desperate, they're getting more and more focused on a particular part of the map instead of trying to find a weak spot to burst through. They're just basically trying to hammer away through sheer brute force, it seems. Fear gun there, firing away. Yes, if I could move that ISU, of course, still need repairs. And there we go. Agent 5 is ready. Panzer's moving for Tiger moving in here. Apparently having learned nothing, he proceeds with the exact same maneuver he's made several times. In this case, they're trying to up the flank here. Not bad. There you go. A successful Blitzkrieg assault somehow here from the Germans. But at the same time, does explode to rear. And there you go. We got Stuka close air support going in there. Luftwaffe almost got it. Tiger almost going down. Agent 5, can he get it? ISU abandoned! Oh dear, if only he provided a bit more support there for the Tiger. You know, maybe the other Tiger. Instead, he's moving in from the front. ISU there, knocked out. Kabul is taking heavy losses here in defense of the motherland, the Lorena. And meanwhile, Flaming Hammer's just easing rocket after rocket after rocket. And with that, Strongbird has basically been spent on this assault. I mean, had he done it a bit better, I think he could have done with a lot less casualties. Instead, he's used all his munitions. He just wasted one Tiger plus a lot of his infantry and just getting that ISU. The new Grenadier squad is ready. And Flaming Hammer is still strong. I mean, he's just constantly bombing away and taking heavy damage out on the Germans. Got a half track down the way of all things there from Kabul. Tiger moving back here to deal with engineers reinforcement. Mortar exposed. Suddenly a different fight we've got here. We've got folks trying to salvage everything, so much to salvage, but even then they're getting bombarded here by the field gun. S5 shooting away there, good, good. With 85 mm gun, Tiger falling back. And folks are still hit on fire by the folks going to hear some conscripts. So much. There you go. MG-42 almost knocked out. Katusha Barrage number, I don't know what. Unleashed. Also noting, he seems to be sort of shifting around here to ensure they don't get hit while he's not paying attention. Not a bad idea overall. Not a bad idea overall. Pulling them back, then moving forward when they're ready to fire. Good thinking overall. Good thinking. Also protects a bit there from Barrage. There we go, then in this case. Ow! Good lord, that was lucky. Somehow made it through that Stuka's first barrage. HD5 on the other hand, stuck in the minefield, took most of the hits there. Of course, that is why you have to be careful around being, you know, placing a minefield around your units and like that. In this case, the casualties were heavy then with the HD5 knocked out, but in this case, Flaming Hammer can easily replace losses with another HD5. Infantry sort they lost through here. Got the M5 Hardtack and Maxim putting a stop to that. No armor support here. No crap mover than the M5 though, for Kabul. Assault appear encountering the Dushka and the cart, which is not actually falling apart. MD40 could be moved. Oh, that's actually also spawning, so they could be pinned down like bugs. And oh dear. Units there wiped out, the casualties just keep piling up. A Tiger being repaired, Stukas was being met again. Two mortars standing back, not being used. And now we're actually seeing shock troops here from Kabul moving forward to it. Fulskis almost wiped out. Still in a resource trait. He could get a Panther now he's aiming for the King Tiger, in which case he really should just, you know, trade munitions for fuel. He just aim fast and strong, but should get a fuel cash up, trade his teammate then with that. Katusha moving hit pack forward, they're firing away. And there you go. Not sure what he's thinking here. Might have been a misclick. Either way, though, Flaming Hammer lost his Katusha. Quick bit of veterans there for the pack 40. Other two that almost had to move in and just drown the enemy with more explosions. Tiger desperately trying to escape here. Consequence moving for all time, trying to get off and tank grenades. There we go. Almost got it. And the Stukas was up to cut. Infantry being wiped out. And there goes the five moves ahead. Shot bounced off. In the pandemonium. Conscripts got wiped out there by the Tiger. Well shot. But the victory points are not looking good for the Germans. They're having a hard time controlling the map at this stage of the fight. Still nothing on the M5. And Sarek really should trade for fuel. I mean, it seems increasingly like he's playing for the King Tiger, but you know, he's not really, you know, feeling rushed towards it apparently, which doesn't really make much sense. I mean, again, had he traded for fuel, had to run to fuel Kaisers, I'm sure he could have had a King Tiger much sooner, and that might have helped a bit. More slaughter of infantry here by the Katushas, just a hail of rockets, which besides turning this into a moon crater landscape, just obliterates any infantry he comes into contact with. 13 and 20 there, veterans you two. Oh dear, Panzer's assault here might actually work out. We got a Tiger moving in. Finally seems to be some greater thoughts of maneuver there from Stormingbird. Though it's not all safe as we do see here. Of course, Flaming Hammer taking advantage of the time here where there's been no action to lay down a further minefield in front of the field guns. Basically, a two-layer minefield there. Good, good. Except, of course, if the enemy charging into it. And there we go. Tiger straight into it. And just of the worst luck, heavy engine damage again. No support, no nothing, no mortar, no anything that could help lay down the smoke screen or something. Panzer is charging into further mines. Strongbird's assault here has floundered helplessly like a beached whale. And there we go, game over. A loss for Germany, a loss for the Reich. Pretty interesting 2v2, in particular to how Flaming Hammer sort of used, you know, his defensive doctrine rather actually that, but all some pretty good stuff there. Too bad it really wasn't tested, in part because that was also part of the reason they lost. Sarek was overall too defensive, he just sort of went, you know, I've got this, I don't have to do any further. That's a very dangerous line of thinking there. He could easily, I think, have an opportunity to sort of flank in, harass the other opponent, do some heavy damage by catching them from an angle they weren't expecting. Instead, he basically allowed them to sort of overwhelm Strongbird several times. Strongbird paid heavily, and then Sarek said, I mean, he'd basically been doing nothing. He hadn't been using his fortification doctrines, you know, fortify. He could have laid down tank traps himself. Trenches, flag emplacements, bunkers, minefields. He could have been doing a lot, yet none of it happened. None of it happened. I mean, that was really probably the worst part of it. He was so defensive, but at the same time, he didn't even use the time he had to do anything with it. Failed to use, oh, finally there, but also lack of fuel cash, I think, for the Germans also hurt them. Strongbird, you know, waiting for Tigers, not good in particular when your opponent or teammate's playing defensive. Not good at all. He should have gone for some regular armor and sort of added up there, and he should have been more aggressive and mobile himself. Probably used some half tracks, and that bunker there certainly was a bit of a bust. Nicely played there by Surge, good use of doctrine. cargo though, floating way, way too many resources, way, way too often. He could have gone for more fuel caches. That's definitely not okay. But otherwise, great use for the Katusas there. Great use. Absolutely stellar stuff there. And decent armor use there by Carbo. So let's hope you enjoyed this match. Hope you learned something from it. I hope it gave some ideas for the matches. If you did, why not subscribe, tell your friends, share it with everyone. If not, you send a replay or some feedback in the comment section. This is Imperial Dane. Cheers and thank you all for watching. Bye.